Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Philosopher's Flight, a novel by Tom Miller. Read by Gibson Frazier.
Prologue. But you must never call philosophy magic, for there is no such thing. Traditional. A few weeks ago, my daughter, who is 9 years old and learning to fly, asked me the question I've been expecting for a long time. Why do so many people hate empirical philosophers? She and I were out drawing koru sigils on the tomato plants in the garden, the sun hot on our backs, each of us with a little square of glass in our hand and a mister filled with distilled water. I'd spent so many hours drawing them as a boy that the rhythm came back to me automatically. Four sprays to coat the glass, aim at a single seedling, then trace your finger through the beads of water, forming the elaborate curlicue that is a koru sigil. Draw it right, and the tomatoes will grow to 4 pounds each and mature twice as fast an ordinary plant. That sort of miracle is the most common thing in the world to my daughter, who was born down here in Matamoros in 1930, 2 miles across the Mexican border. Raised among malcontents and renegades, women, and a few men, like myself, who were made outlaws in the United States. All of us are empirical philosophers, or sigilrists, if you prefer the common term. And what is empirical philosophy? What is sigilry, except a branch of science that we don't yet fully understand? There's no dark art to it. It's nothing more than the movement of energy to produce a physical effect. The human body provides the energy, while the sigil, drawn sometimes with beads of water, sometimes with cornmeal or sand, catalyzes the movement. You can do 1,000 useful things with philosophy. Make a plant grow larger and faster. Send a message 1,000 miles in an instant. Fly. If you grew up with it, it's natural. It's right. Why would anyone want life to be otherwise? But of course, not everyone feels that way. Sigilry only came into widespread use around 1750, and right from the start, women were better at it than men. That upset a lot of folks, who thought sigils must be some form of witchcraft. Most people, though, saw the usefulness in empirical philosophy and were content to allow it. So it went until 1831, when we get to what every 9-year-old girl calls the good part. And that's Lucretia Cadwallader, who at that same age, hidden away in a remote cabin in Wisconsin, illiterate and with no knowledge of empirical philosophy at all, devised a method for solidifying smoke and shaping it with her bare hands. When she traced the right glyph into a cloud of smoke with her finger, it became docile. She could make it stretch like taffy, or fill an entire room, or coil itself neatly in a jar. For years, young Cadwallader practiced her trade in secret, until the University of Detroit heard of her extraordinary abilities and invited her to study as a scholarship case. Cadwallader spent 3 decades at the U of D engaged in endless study and experimentation, learning how to combine her smoke with chemical vapors to create complex structures. Her clouds could take on the properties of a spring or harden into a mass that struck like a fist. They could asphyxiate a man or burn away tuberculosis or bring the rain. Because she often used a pocket knife to shape her clouds, Cadwallader named her technique smoke carving. The leading philosophers of her age called Cadwallader's discoveries scientific breakthroughs of the highest order. Lay people called them the devil's work. That sort of superstition always infuriated Cadwallader. You could take a man with no notion of chemistry and have him hold a match to gunpowder, or breathe ether and he'd call it honest knowledge. But if you accomplish the same physical effects by tracing out a glyph in hot ash or silver filings, he would declare it the lowest form of wickedness. Cadwallader took on students, too, the most unusual of whom was a young male sigilrist named Galen Wainwright. Though Wainwright possessed only a fraction of Cadwallader's power, he was nevertheless quite talented for a man. He had a grand vision of forming the world's first military unit to fight using smoke carving. Cadwallader always dismissed the idea. Smoke carving was a tool of peace and creation, not of destruction. When the Civil War broke out in 61, Wainwright went to Washington, where he offered to raise a regiment of smoke carvers and defeat the Confederacy in a week. The Secretary of War laughed him right out of the city. Wainwright then made the same offer to the Confederates in Richmond, who didn't see any harm in the idea and made Wainwright a colonel. Then, from every last corner of the South, Wainwright sought out men who could do empirical philosophy. Most of them were inept practical sigilrists, but they had high spirits and kitted themselves out in the elaborate uniforms of zouaves. They called themselves the Legion of Confederate Smoke Carvers. The Legion's first action came at the Battle of Bull Run, where it brewed up a huge cloud of tear gas, intending to break the Union lines. However, Wainwright miscalculated the wind speed and instead hit a group of picnicking dignitaries who'd come down from Baltimore to watch the fighting. His attack didn't affect the outcome of the battle, but it did throw the entire North into an uproar over the philosophical menace. The Legion spent the next 10 months fighting in one skirmish after another, putting on overwhelming pyrotechnic displays. They caused only a few dozen casualties while exhausting the South's supply of strategic chemicals. And yet the mere sight of Wainwright and his men in their baggy scarlet pantaloons, blue silk jackets, and tasseled fezes inspired panic in the Union Army. Back in Virginia, the Legion was feted as the most ingenious weapon of the Confederacy. Until, at last, Mrs. Cadwallader took the field. She led what came to be known as the United States Sigilry Corps. 10,000 women, all practical philosophers. They marched out of Detroit with a vast, silent, slate-gray cyclone that billowed a mile high. "Like the Israelites," wrote the overawed Detroit defender, "with a pillar of cloud to lead them by day and a pillar of fire by night." In reality, it was nothing so biblical, merely a supply of concentrated pre-made smoke so they could strike more quickly. Galen Wainwright knew a losing proposition when he saw one. He fainted and retreated across the length of Tennessee before at last the Corps cornered the Legion on the night of Halloween, 1862. Wainwright's display of flash and fire lasted all of 51 seconds before Cadwallader's women brought down a blanket of smoke that pulled the oxygen right out of the air, extinguishing his colorful flames. 9/10 of the Legion surrendered on the spot, but Wainwright and his most fervent followers escaped to a nearby gully to make their last stand. Cadwallader wished to avoid killing fellow philosophers. Instead of smothering the Legion, the Corps put up smoke streamers impregnated with lead iodide, which seeded the clouds and produced torrential rains. Wainwright's final attack was washed away. He himself suffered a bad case of pneumonia and was carried back to Richmond, where he spent the remainder of the war writing his memoirs. Nevertheless, the South fought on and the huge loss of life on both sides continued. Dismayed at the bloodshed, Cadwallader demanded to be allowed to attack the Confederacy directly. Escorted by William Tecumseh Sherman's army, Cadwallader and the Corps made their way to Atlanta. She sent ahead a brief note that read, "I will burn the city to the ground on Sunday at 4 a.m. So fearsome was Mrs. Cadwallader's reputation that nearly the entire civilian population evacuated. The Corps surrounded the city on Saturday afternoon, and all through the night, Cadwallader's women sent wisps of incendiary vapor creeping through the Confederate lines. Right on schedule, fire erupted, moving west to east, permitting enough time for the stragglers to flee, but leveling every building in its wake, sparing not even the churches. Cadwallader marched from Atlanta to the sea, burning everything in her path, cutting a swath 10 miles wide. Her advance was unstoppable. Finally, she arrived at Petersburg, Virginia, the last bastion of Confederate resistance. besieging the city were General Grant and his army, exhausted after a months-long campaign that had failed to pry 40,000 Confederate defenders from their impenetrable web of trenches. On the morning of April 6, 1865, the Southern soldiers watched as tendrils of smoke probed their lines and vanished into the ground. They waited for an ultimatum. Cadwallader had never attacked without warning or killed unnecessarily.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.